Welcome to the DevOps Lab. On this episode, we are joined by a very special guest, April Edwards. How's it going, April?
Thank you, Abel. Awesome. Glad to be here again.
Yes. Today, we're going to do more deep dive into Terraform. You told me we're going to talk about modules, correct?
We are, yes.
All right. Explain to me what a module even is.
So when we wrote our Terraform files before, we had everything in a main.tf file, right?
Correct.
In one file. But when we start building bigger environments, mm-hmm. we need to break those up and call variables, right?
Okay.
So we use modules instead of calling a resource, because those files, those main files, get really long, really complex.
Mm-hmm.
And remember when we talked about ARM templates versus Terraform files, mm-hmm. the advantage of Terraform is we can do it in shorter code, right?
Sure.
So we're going to condense it, use the modules, but it makes it repeatable and makes it redeployable, which is the advantage of the cloud, right?
Sure.
So not just one data center, one environment, multiple environments.
So a module, would you say, is kind of like a function when you're programming, or a method when you're programming?
Yes, it's very much like calling a method, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what we need to do is call that quote method, which is a module in this case, and mm-hmm. tell Terraform to deploy that.
Okay.
And it'll be in a much larger environment, right? So that we're not just deploying one big file and scrolling through so much code. We can call the module, and we can just make changes to the module
and not
have to make changes to our entire code base as well.
Right. So this module, would you say like a module is like a deployable unit? Like some deployable unit?
Yes. So if you look up at the screen here, so in our previous deployments, we called what's called a resource here.
Mm-hmm.
We're calling the resource. We're using the Azure provider here and calling the resource group, and we're giving it a title and whatnot. So we're putting in variables in place instead of giving it discrete names. So in the previous deployments with you, I've kind of just put in the actual location, like West Europe, East US, wherever. We're using a variable instead of doing... we want to make it repeatable and scalable. Okay. I'm also adding tags into this deployment. So tagging is really great for environments because you know what's been deployed. It helps with the billing cycle and also giving access permissions across the environment. So
sure.
I'm just adding an extra layer of neatness to it.
Okay.
So that's a resource. So instead of calling a resource, I'm going to now call a module. So what Terraform does, and this is our main.tf template still,
mm-hmm.
it's going to define the resource group, and then in order, it's then going to call the modules in line. Okay?
I see. Yep.
So we're going to call the module, and it's called application-vnet.
Okay.
And the source is modules/vnet.
Okay.
So if I go to my modules folder here, I have one that calls vnet. Now, each one of these modules folder also will have a main file, an output file, and a variables file.
Okay.
So it has a very similar main file. So let's use the example of the vnet one here.
Mm-hmm.
We go into the main one, and it's calling the variables still.
But it's
defining the resource. So if we want to expand this and add in other resources to it, we'd add it to the module. And so we can create modules for elements in the environment we want to either add or take away. So we could add security roles, we could add, you know, web apps, we could add functions, we could add a whole other slew of stuff and add it module by module or
mm-hmm.
take it away module by module, right?
Yeah. Yep.
So the only downside with the module, and I'm going to say really downside, the caveat is it's dependent on the entire environment that you're deploying to. So everything in that environment is going to call on that module set.
Right.
Okay?
Okay.
So in this case, what we want to do is build out our data center in Azure, and we want to develop a little bit of a framework. Now, when you go into organizations and talk to them about how they're deploying and how they're testing and running their code, do they ever have the same environments? For like dev, test, and production?
Very rarely.
Right?
Yeah.
And it's a big complaint. You go and talk to a dev team and they laugh because they're out of capacity or it's not the same hardware, it's not the same OS levels, everything's different. So in real life, how are we actually able to test our code if our environments are different? We're adding in, you know, extraneous options that could to completely blow our applications out of the water, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this, what we're going to do today is build three identical environments in Azure
mm-hmm.
using modules, so they have the exact same configuration.
Okay.
Now, yes, we're building three different environments, but what we're also going to do is separate them out so they're managed a little bit independently. Okay. So before, when we talked about the state file, we added another element called a workspace.
Okay.
So when we do one main file, we have what's called the default workspace,
mm-hmm.
and we had one state file.
Okay.
Because I want to deploy three different environments, I actually want to manage them separately, but mm-hmm. have the exact same infrastructure in them, if that
sure.
makes sense. So these modules are going to deploy the same infrastructure, but as you can see, I have it listed here in my folder structure. I have a dev environment, a test environment, and a production environment.
Okay.
Now they're all going to call in the modules, they're all going to use the main file.
Mm-hmm.
What we've done is put in a tvars file, which actually is going to give us different variables for that environment.
Got it.
Okay.
Yep.
So I need to know, how do I differentiate my environments, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we're just going to call this environment C9 demo for channel 9.
Mm-hmm.
The environment is dev. Now I've chosen my location and my capacity.
Got
so
it.
That capacity, again, is going to tie to our virtual machine scale set.
Yep.
And if I go into my test environment, we've called the exact same variables, okay, except I've put in three VMs, and I've called the environment test. So everything's going to have that tag added to it so I can differentiate my three different environments.
Got it.
On top of that, it's going to write to three different state files. So what that means is if I'm working in my test or my dev environment, it's not going to affect production.
Got it.
So we have separation of environments.
So let me run this back really, really quickly just to make sure I understand again. Using one main.tf file, which is basically like the blueprint of this is how I want my environments to be built out, you're now able to create three identical environments, your dev, your QA, and your production environments. And then by passing in variables using the same main.tf file, now you're able to kind of tweak the different environments based off of the variables. So maybe you want your dev environment in Western Europe, and then maybe you want your QA environment in, I don't know, Western United States for whatever reason.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. And we have customers that do that because they have dev teams and teams across the globe. But I think, you know, I want to focus just on that we're deploying this all to one location.
Okay,
but what
sure.
we can do, yes, is change that variable to another location. So maybe we want to take this environment and spin it up somewhere entirely different, like the East US or West Europe or UK West or wherever, right?
Yeah.
All we have to do is change that variable and we have the exact same environment. So for global organizations, this is key, right?
Yeah.
This is a game changer.
Yeah.
So now your dev team isn't going back to your ops team and going, I need these resources. And they're like, oh, we don't have it. Oh, everything's different. We can deploy the exact same environments across the globe.
Fantastic.
Literally, right?
Yep.
Cool. So I want to actually just show you what I've done a little bit. So I told you we're going to have state files in for different environments. So remember that kind of that label that had called the variable for dev, test, and prod, right? It's attached to the state file. So these state files are sitting in my Azure storage account. It's calling Key Vault, so I've secured it down. So we just did, you know, we talked about the state files and how those work, but I have actually separated those out, right?
I see. Yep. Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
And also with this, in my code, I've implemented a workspace. So my dev environment has its own state file, its own environment, its own virtual network, so it's segmented.
Yep.
And it has what's called a workspace. So I can edit our dev environment and not touch the others and not have that risk of bringing everything down, right?
Yes.
Again, another game changer. So how does a workspace work, right? So I want to just go back into my resource groups in Azure. And if you can see up here, I've already created our dev, test, and prod environment.
Okay. Okay?
So let's go into dev. You know, I kind of talked about we had two virtual machines running. Here we go. So we have our virtual machine scale set. We have our own virtual network. So we can set up a peer to talk to the other networks. But right now, these are three independent environments built identically with virtual machine scale sets. So I go into my scale set here.
Cool.
And I can see that I have two instances running.
Yep.
Boom, right there. I also talked about the tagging thing. I've tagged my environment right down here. So I know what the application is listed as. It was deployed by Terraform. I know what environment in it I'm in and what type of environment it's a VM scale set environment. We can do the exact same thing for our data environments, our web apps, our containers environments. We can put tags to it so we know exactly what we're deploying to and we have a record of it. And someone who likes to handle the billing side can also see that, right?
Right.
We've kind of covered all our bases.
Right. Right.
So I want to manipulate what we've done. So let's say, for instance, you know, we have our dev environment and maybe we need to rebuild it or we don't like it. Okay.
Sure.
Let's get rid of it. Let's get rid of dev, but not affect test or production environments. So
okay.
I talked about this element of workspace. So I've created this workspace for dev. And if you see here, instead of going Terraform init, Terraform plan, Terraform apply, if we've done in the past, we have to select our workspace first.
Got it. Sure.
Because we're not working off that default workspace. We have divided it up and carved it out for, you know, we've given it a logical separation. So with Terraform workspace, I'm going to select, we're going to go dev, type in dev. And what it's going to do, it's going to say, right, I've switched to the workspace dev here. Now I can type in prod or test, and it'll also switch to those. So what I want to do is I want to actually destroy that environment because maybe, I don't know, we don't need it or we want to do something different with it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to, so I'm calling the variable file. If you remember, I have the dev, remember that variable file that we called with all the, so I'm just calling that now.
Okay.
In my line of code and say, right, I want to destroy that variable file and everything in it.
Gotcha.
Right?
Yep.
So we've called the workspace. So it's acquiring state locks. So remember we talked about state files, right? We're locking out that state file only in dev and we're not going to touch production and test.
Okay.
So it's going to lock it out so no one else can touch it.
Cool.
And then it's going to come up and it's going through the resources and saying what is existing in that environment, and then it's going to go, are you sure you want to delete?
Sure.
Let's do it, right?
Of course.
So it's pulling everything up. It's okay. Listing everything up. Again, we can output this to a file. We can document it. We can do other things with it. We can have different versioning as well. So yes, let's destroy it.
Perfect.
Let's see what happens.
So now it's going to go into Azure and just destroy my dev environment.
Exactly. Dev's going to be gone in a moment.
Yeah.
So that would be really cool.
Very cool stuff.
Definitely. I think, you know, we work with so many organizations that struggle to get identical environments and to manage those environments because the teams are having to manually do things, et cetera. Terraform can take over that element of management, right?
Sure.
And this has been pretty easy to do today. And you know, you can do this on-prem. We can't do scale sets, but we can manage our on-prem environments. We can also do the other cloud. Mm-hmm. So if a multi-cloud strategy or an on-prem environment, we can start managing our with our operations teams more efficiently.
Awesome stuff. Very, very cool. So basically today, you've shown us the power of Terraform, especially when you start using modules, when you start using variables, and also workspaces. Man, this has been great stuff. Thank you again. So all you devs out there, go to Terraform, check this stuff out, start building out your infrastructure with Terraform. Fun stuff. Thank you so much, April.
Thank you, Abel.